Gloria Ramirez was known to be the life of the party, a woman who was admired for her joie de vivre. Indeed, she was loved by everyone, foremost by her two children and her husband, the Reverend Brian Taylor. Nothing about her life hinted at the fact that, coursing through her veins, a toxic mystery threatened to break out at any time. All that changed on the fateful day of February 19, 1994, when she was rushed to the General Hospital in Riverside, California. Her heart was racing and her blood pressure had become dangerously low. The woman could hardly string a sentence together, and things didn't look good at all. The doctors and nurses did their best to keep Ramirez alive, but what has confounded the scientific community ever since is the fact that many of the people who treated her came down with something awful and unexplainable. It's as if Ramirez was toxic. Her very presence, like the approach of death's pale shadow from medical staff, unfortunate enough to be around her. But how does a person become toxic? The case was unheard of, and as you'll find out, scientists are still debating what happened. Conspiracy theorists have their own say in the matter, and if they're right, something very dark happened that day. Maybe here at the Infographic Show we can get to the bottom of this case. We'll try our best, but we warn you, it's a complicated and amazing story at the same time. First of all, you should know that when Ramirez was admitted to the emergency room, she was already suffering from the late stages of cervical cancer. She'd only known this for 6 weeks, since the cancer was what sometimes was called the silent type. Her having cancer is an important matter in this story, but it surely doesn't explain what happened next. Okay, so Ramirez was in a state of shock. She could hardly speak, and her heart rate was not stable, and her breathing was erratic. When asked to move her limbs or respond to questions, she was unable to do so. A nurse gave her three different kinds of sedatives to try to calm her down, but they had no effect at all. Things were now getting serious. Ramirez's heart was failing her. The poor lady was staring death in the face. The doctor said, "This woman is going to die. Bring out the defibrillator." Everyone stood back, and boom, hundreds of volts of electricity were delivered to Ramirez to try and get her heart beating correctly again. It wasn't working, so they gave her another shock. At this point, something strange happened, something none of the people around Ramirez had ever seen before. Her chest was suddenly covered in a viscous, oil-like substance, and a nurse said that a garlic smell was coming from the dying woman's mouth. This was not a vague smell. It filled the entire room, and everyone noticed it. The puzzled and bewildered nurses and doctors, who had never seen anything like this before, took a blood sample from Ramirez's arm. But when they drew her blood, they made another shocking discovery. Her blood positively reeked of ammonia, strong enough to make some of the hospital staff choke and gag. The nurse who drew the blood, one Susan Kane, noticed that strange clumps of something were floating around in Ramirez's arms. And she turned to her colleague Julie Gorchinsky and said, "Hey, do you think these strange particles could be what's causing the ammonia smell?" Before Gorchinsky could even respond, Kane fell to the floor and fainted. A few minutes later, Gorchinsky said she felt terribly lightheaded and felt as if she was about to throw up. Like Kane, she was taken out of the emergency room, but before she could be asked about her symptoms, she also fainted. Ramirez's blood was toxic, possibly lethal. The emergency medical personnel sprung into action to contain the situation, but one by one they too fell victim to Ramirez's toxic alien-like blood. A respiratory therapist named Maureen Welch was the next to go. One second she was standing up, and the next she was on the floor. Something strange was certainly afoot, so the head doctor said, "Get all the people outside of the emergency ward immediately and take them to the parking lot." Something toxic was indeed making people very ill, and it was coming from Ramirez, who seemed unaffected by her own volatile blood. But of course, they couldn't just leave Ramirez lying there. Some staff had to stay behind to try and keep the woman alive. The sad thing is, after 45 minutes of CPR and defibrillation, she died of kidney failure that was related to her cancer. Her death was not that unusual, since she was in the late stages of cancer, but what was incredibly unusual was the fact that 23 people who'd been close to this so-called toxic lady became ill, with 5 folks having to be hospitalized because of dangerous muscle spasms and shortness of breath. One person almost didn't make it, but recovered after 2 weeks in intensive care. After that, she had lifelong health problems. A team of people dressed in hazmat suits were called in to handle the body and then check the room for any signs of toxins, strange gases, or anything else that could make people ill. They found nothing out of the ordinary. There was no sign of anything that could have made people pass out. The Department of Health and Human Services was then called in, and 2 doctors investigated the case. Could the woman really have been toxic? Was there such a thing as a toxic lady? It was totally unheard of, and still is for that matter. So these 2 doctors, Ana Maria Osorio and Kirsten Waller, interviewed all the people who had been in the emergency room that day. That amounted to 34 staff. but it appeared that those who suffered the most severe illnesses were the ones who had been the closest to Ramirez. Most of the severe cases had been women, but all their blood tests revealed that nothing had contaminated them. This didn't make sense to the investigators, and they simply said that those people were merely the victims of mass hysteria. Maybe you don't know what that is, but mass hysteria tends to affect women more than men. Okay, so case closed. Those health professionals just come down with a malady of the mind. But no, the case wasn't closed, and it wouldn't be closed for a long time to come. Some of those women that had been the worst affected were irate that the investigators had said they'd been sickened only by a temporary madness. They knew how they'd felt. They had smelled the vicious odor coming from Ramirez's body. They had seen with their own eyes the sheen on her body and the strange particles in her blood. And anyway, they were seasoned professionals. They wouldn't become hysterical at the sight of a sick person. Was that investigation some kind of cover-up? What was the hospital trying to hide? Gorshinsky was the most irate, and she deserved to be, since after the incident she developed hepatitis and something called avascular necrosis in her knees. In simple terms, it's the death of bone tissue. It's a serious condition, and so of course Gorshinsky didn't like being told that she'd merely been hysterical. She was right to be suspicious. And now the story takes another turn, but certainly not its last. Forensic pathologists came up with a postulation as to what might have happened. We say might because a lot of experts in the medical field don't agree with their report. They said that Ramirez had been taking something called dimethyl sulfoxide, which is usually referred to as DMSO. This can be used to treat pain or speed up the healing of wounds. It can orally be ingested or applied to the skin as a gel or a cream. Now, there's nothing too unusual about taking DMSO. It's a drug that's been approved by the FDA. Moreover, those who have tasted it say it tastes like garlic. Ah, so was the drug the reason for the garlic smell coming from Ramirez? And could the sheen on her body have been from the DMSO gel or cream? Even if she had daubed herself with DMSO, that wouldn't have made people faint. The investigators then added some more to the story. They explained that when Ramirez was given oxygen, that might have turned the DMSO into something called dimethyl sulfone or DMSO2. The substance has been used as a medicine by people, and some experts believe it can promote better health in small doses. Trials, however, have revealed that it can also have some nasty side effects. The forensic pathologist said in their report that since the substance crystallizes at room temperature, it would explain the particles seen in Ramirez's blood. The report said there was a reason why things went crazy, and they all postulated that the DMSO2 was then turned into the highly toxic dimethyl sulfate, DMSO4. After the electric shocks were given to Ramirez. They also said that the change in room temperature and oxygen being added to the DMSO2 could have converted it to the toxic DMSO4. If a person inhales the vapors of dimethyl sulfate, they can die over a period of hours. In fact, one investigator read in a classified Department of Defense document that was written in 1987 that just 10 minutes of exposure to this substance can kill a person over a period of time. The document said that just 1 gram of it, when dispersed in a cubic meter of air, can kill the people that breathe it. The thing was, the Ramirez family said she had never taken DMSO and wouldn't have done such a thing, and they called the hospital out and said the DMSO story was a big bag of bull, and they were covering something up. What happened next is Ramirez was dug up, but this was 2 months after she'd been buried. The family demanded an independent autopsy, but the problem was her heart was missing. This meant the family's pathologist couldn't really say what happened. He said the body was so decomposed it was difficult to get the truth. Meanwhile, the Riverside coroner's office stuck with a DMSO story. The family was incensed, knowing full well that Ramirez had never used DMSO. Her husband said he knew this for a matter of fact. Other medical experts have chimed in on the matter, saying that while the story is exceptional and incredibly unusual, the DMSO postulation is the only thing that makes sense. Still, it's only a theory, just one that is an incredible theory according to some experts in medical science. Not all medical science, though, including Hans Reich, a man who was an organic chemist at the University of Wisconsin at Madison. He'd worked with the substances before, and he had said he couldn't see DMSO going through these stages and turning to a dangerous vapor. Then, there were even more medical experts who came out and said that the symptoms that the hospital staff experienced just didn't match dimethyl sulfate poisoning. The reason they knew what the symptoms looked like is because in the past industrial workers had been accidentally exposed to the stuff. A physiologist and professor of neurosurgery at the University of New Mexico named Jack De La Torre said that exposure to the substance in vapor form would first act like tear gas, and the hospital staff would have cried. That didn't happen. He said that if dimethyl sulfate was to blame, it would have taken several hours for the nasty effects to happen, and that would have affected the people's eyes, nose, and mouth, and finally gotten to the lungs and possibly caused pulmonary edema. Fainting on the spot, said De La Torre, ain't what happens when you get hit with DMS-04. Yet another medical expert called the DMS-04 theory a chemical impossibility. Perhaps the incredible theory was not DMS-04 poisoning, but the possibility of those staff being exposed to a substance called methylamine. This smells like ammonia, and remember that Ramirez's blood had the smell of ammonia. Methylamine exposure can also cause eye, nose, and throat irritation, and if enough is breathed, it can lead to edema of the lungs. It can also cause dizziness and fainting. According to the National Advisory Committee for Acute Exposure Guideline Levels for Hazardous 5 Substances, what you might not know about this substance is the fact that it's used to make the illegal drug called methamphetamine. You might also not know that at the time, Riverside County was a main distribution point for this very strong type of speed. But why on earth would meth have been in a hospital? The reason, say some conspiracy theorists, is that some staff were using IV bags to smuggle meth. It dissolves in water and is sometimes transported in water. If Ramirez was put on a meth drip, it would explain the fact that her heart rate went through the roof and she might have actually died of an overdose. We should say that this is a wild theory and there's nothing substantial to back it up, and it's highly unlikely that meth vapors would have been so toxic to the staff at the hospital. In the end, the story remains one of medical science's great mysteries. How did a dying woman become a chemical time bomb for the people around her? Maybe some of our sleuths watching this show can put forward their own theory. Now, you really have to see this show. What is the deadliest substance on Earth? Toxicity comparison. Or take a look at this video.